Well, good morning, everybody. Well, I hope you all had a wonderful week. I hope you're enjoying this good old weather we've been having the last couple of days. I'll only joke some of you this morning, right? I know it's about 95 about now, but we're glad you're here this morning. We're going to start out this morning by singing one of my favorite songs, actually a couple of my favorite songs here. It keeps me singing in sunshine of my soul. And I hope all of you came this morning, first of all, with joy in your heart, right? Joy in your heart. Two honks, I heard you. All right. Rest of you can honk later, right? And also with sunshine in your soul. So let's sing about that. There's within my heart a melody, Jesus whispers sweet and low. Fear not, I am with thee, peace be still, in all of my stem and flow. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know. Fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Soon he's coming back to welcome me, far beyond the starry sky. I shall wing my flight to worlds unknown. I shall reign with him on high. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know. Fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. There is sunshine in my soul today, more glorious and bright than glows in the earthly sky. For Jesus is my light. Oh, there's sunshine, blessed sunshine, when the peaceful, happy moments roll. When Jesus shows his smiling face, there is sunshine in my soul. There is gladness in my soul today, and hope and love and praise. For blessings which he gives me now, for joys in future days. Oh, there's sunshine, blessed sunshine, peaceful, happy moments roll. When Jesus shows his smiling face, there is sunshine in my soul. Everybody said?
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Beautiful day it is, even though it's not the kind of weather your preacher likes best. But you know what? If I was in control of it, somebody would be unhappy anyway. I got an announcement I want to make before I begin. It says anyone who wants to help with VBS this year, which will be a one-day outdoor socially distanced event, should contact me this week. Now, me is not me, that's Sherry Johnson. So contact her this week. It'll be in the evening due to the heat, 7 to 9 event. Possible dates are Thursday or Friday, June 18th or 19th, or June 25th or 26th. So if you could call Sherry Johnson this week at 256-762-1802. Let her know if you'd be willing to help with Vacation Bible School. We're going to do it a little bit differently, obviously, than what we're accustomed to, but because of some circumstances beyond beyond our control. That will be a plan for us this year. Again, I want to welcome you. We're so glad you're here. We thank you for coming. I believe all of the comments that I heard from last week were positive, and folks enjoyed coming and at least being here on the church campus and enjoying a time of worship together. And so we're thankful this morning that you've come. I want us to open up with a time of prayer, and then I'm going to share some thoughts with you. Father, thank you this morning for your love. I thank you, God, for your grace. I thank you for your strength. Lord, I thank you this morning that, Lord, you hold us in your hand. God, that you hold us up and you strengthen us. And God, we're thankful for the scriptures and the promises that you made to us. And Lord, we're thankful that you said in your word, and we've referred to this so many times in the last couple of months, and in Psalm 46, verses 1 and 2, where it says, "You are our refuge and strength, very present help in trouble. You'll never leave us. You'll never forsake us." And God, we thank you for that today. We just ask you, Lord, that you would lift up all of those this morning who are sick, those who may be, Lord, not well in our church family. God, I just pray that you would lift them up. God, that you would take us all up in your lap, Lord, and just love on us. And Father, I pray that you would give us, Lord, the strength to do what you called us to do. And God, I pray that you would bless this time together this morning. Pray that you would be glorified through it, Lord, and that we'd be blessed for being here and being a part of it. And we ask all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I want to read a passage of Scripture. We're going to do things a little bit different even from here, but just hit me. I don't need to read some Scripture before Justin sings, do I? I forgot Justin. Everybody pause for a minute before I start, okay, because I just remembered what I forgot. Justin Brewer is going to share a special song with us right now, so everybody tune your ear to him. Thank God my yesterday is gone.
There's a kind of thing that just breaks me. Breaking down to his knees. God, I've been broken more than a time or two. Yes, Lord, and he picks me up and shows me what it means to be.
Glad I remembered that. Amen.
Amen.
Beautiful song. Amen. Thank you, Justin. And I apologize for kind of getting confused there. Man. I was starting to say a while ago, we're going to do this, even this part of the service, a little bit differently this morning. I have just been impressed this week to a passage of scripture that I want to share with you. And if you have your Bibles with you, this morning, I want you to turn in those scriptures to the book of 2 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians chapter 4. I'm going to begin reading there with verse 16. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 16, I will begin. And as I said, I just have felt impressed for the last several days to share this passage of scripture with you this morning. And just hear what the word of the Lord says. And I'm going to share a few words, and then we're going to ask our youth pastor to come, and he's going to share a few words. We've both agreed that we would each one do short sermons. Would you say amen? That's enough. All right. Verse 16 of 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Here's what the word of the Lord says. Therefore, we do not lose heart, even though our outward man is perishing. Yet the inward man is being renewed day by day. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, is working for us a far more exceeding and external weight of glory. While we do not look at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal. I want to stop there just for a minute before I can complete the reading of the scripture and just point out a couple of things from these three verses. You know, as we begin to grow older, and many of you, whether we want to be a member of that club or not, or are members of that club, and as we begin to grow older, you know, we sort of begin to, the process of dying. Matter of fact, when we're born onto this earth, we start our life, and we start ending our life, because the Bible tells us that we are only assigned a certain number of days. And then when those days are over, then we will be with the Lord. But, you know, as far as the body is concerned, that's one thing. And Paul said here he said we see our bodies begin to die, and we see them the outward man is perishing, and yet the inward man is being renewed day by day. And I praise God for that this morning. You know, God renews us day by day. And what that means to us is that even though these outward bodies are perishing, he tells us here that we are growing in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Have you ever got up in the mornings and so many things were hurting, you just thought, man, it'd be nice if I could trade this in on a new model? Huh? Yeah, I think we all have. But listen, as those things begin to take place, remember that one day we will. We'll trade this old body in on a new body, on a new model. And verses 17 and 18, Paul said, down here, we have a lot of trouble. And that seems to last a long time. But when we measure it by the weight of glory that's coming soon, it becomes a light affliction. And I don't know about you, but I'm looking this morning for a city whose builder and maker is God. His builder and maker is God. Now I want to complete by reading a few more verses from chapter 5 of 2 Corinthians. And here's what the word says. For we know that if our earthly house, this tent, is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. For in this we groan, earnestly desiring to be clothed with our habitation, which is from heaven. If indeed, having been clothed, we shall not be found naked, because when we meet the Lord, we will be clothed in his righteousness and in his glory. Verse 4 then says, for we who are in this tent groan, being burdened, not because we want to be unclothed, but further clothed, and mortality may be swallowed up by life. Now he who has prepared us for this very thing is God, who also has given us the Spirit as a guarantee. For we are always confident, knowing that while we are at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord. For we walk by faith, not by sight. We are confident, yes, well pleased, rather, to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. Now, verse 9, as we conclude these thoughts. Therefore, we make it our aim, whether present or absent, to be well-pleasing to him. And I believe what that tells us this morning, my friends, is no matter what circumstances we find ourselves in, until we meet the Lord and until we're clothed in his righteousness and in his glory, and until we inherit that city whose maker and builder is God, then we must work every day to be more pleasing to him. Father, we thank you this morning for your scriptures. Thank you for the word. God, we just thank you that you can strengthen us so often through your word. And God, we ask you now that you'd bless Brother Tony as he comes and shares some words with us this morning. May you bless him and use him to speak your word. In Jesus' name, amen.
I want to read to you this morning in 1 John chapter 4. I'm going to start with verse 7. We'll read to the end of the chapter there, 1 John. 1 John chapter 4, verse 7 says, beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God, and whoever loves is born of God and knows God. Anyone who does not love God does not know God, because God is love. In this the love of God is made manifest among us. God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. And this is love, not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation of our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God abides in us, His love is perfected in us. By this we know that we abide in Him and He in us, because He has given us His Spirit. And we have seen and testified that the Father has sent His Son to be the Savior of the world. Whoever confesses that Jesus is the Son of God, God abides in him and he in God. So we have come to know and to believe that God, believe the love that God has for us. God is love, and whoever abides in love abides in God, and God abides in him. By this is love perfected with us, so that we may have confidence for the day of judgment. Because as he who is also, then we are in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. For fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not been perfected in love. We love because first he loved us. If anyone says, I love God, and hates his brother, he is a liar. He does not love his brother whom he has seen. How can he love God whom he has not seen? This commandment we have from him, whoever loves God must also love his brother. I started reading these verses because there's been a lot of crazy things going on this year. I actually saw a meme kind of thing the other day, and it's, you know, this kind of picture that was, they were saying that they found this cave, and in this cave they had all these different species. I think that there's 33 different species that they found in this cave, and they were talking about opening up and checking it out, and somebody else replied, it's 2020, this is not the year, seal that thing back up, because of all the crazy things that have been going on this year. And when you think about the craziness, if you watch the news over the last few months, you know, you've seen a lot of crazy things, but a lot of people are searching to make life better, to make this life, you know, seem have to have a purpose, but they're all looking in the wrong places. They're looking in the wrong places because they're trying to find love, and we cannot find love apart from God, because these scriptures currently tell us God is love. There is no definition of Him apart from Him, apart from who God is. So we have to look at love and who God says it is. And if you look at the definition of love we have in this world, it's always changing. But what do we also know about God? He does not change. He's the same today as He's going to be forever. That's who He is. So the love definition we have to look in His Word for that definition. When we try to look for it apart from His Word, we're not going to find it. So I think we need to kind of focus in on what His Word actually tells us. And when we hear the term God is love, we also need to know that what it says, what love is. And a lot of times people say, you know, that love, and you hear this a lot in society, love means you support me in anything. Well, here's what I want you to know. I believe my parents loved me, but they haven't supported me when I was wrong.
Amen.
They called me on that. And that's what God's going to do to us, right? For us to come to know Christ, He tells us that we're sinners in need of a Savior. We need to repent of our sins, and we need to live for Him. We need to believe in Him. We need to follow Him. So that part of the definition of love we need to understand, too. God is love, but He's also just. And He's also going to demand a ransom for our sin. We have that ransom in Jesus, but we have to put our faith and trust in Him. So that part of the definition of love, I think, is important for us to understand. In verse 7, it says, we are called to love each other. And if you think of all the craziness in this world, we're trying to look for ways to love each other, and we're trying to look for ways to love each other in this world, we're never going to get it. We're never going to understand it. But God can see and show us the way to love each other. He's the only one that can. What greater way can we see love than in Jesus, in what He did for us, in the sacrifice He made for us? So we can search for it. People try to use politics to understand what love is. That's not going to help. Apart from God, we can't find it. It's not there. So we need to make sure that we understand that. Socioeconomic issues, morals, all these different things that we're trying to understand these things and understand what's right and what's wrong. We find them all in God. We cannot find them apart from Him. We find them, those things in the Word that He's left us. Scripture tells us it's going to be this way. If you read Romans 1, it says that we abandon who God is. We abandon worshiping Him for created things. We start to worship created things rather than Creator Himself. And when we do that, we mess up the definition of what love is. We won't understand it. And what the world needs to see now, more than ever, it's always been the same. We've always had sin in this world. I don't think the world's more evil than it's been. I think we just know more than we've ever known. Right. Because we can see more. There's more media. There's more news. There's more ways to access information than we've had before. The world's always been this way. We don't have to look very far in Genesis to see the first sin. And we don't have to look very far in Genesis to see all the sins. About how they were manifesting. But we do know that God is the only answer to those things. And that we're supposed to be set apart. We're supposed to be different in this world. And the way we show that we're different is that we love each other. We first love God, then we love each other. In verse 8, it tells that, that if we don't love people, if we don't know God. And it reaffirms that later on in the scripture, these scriptures that we read. But we need to make sure that we love each other. And the easy part of loving each other is hopefully all of us here love each other. One reason we're like-minded is that we believe that Jesus is the Son of God. We believe that he died on the cross to save us from our sin. We believe on the third day he rose from the dead. We believe one day he's coming back to take us home with him forever. That's one thing that unites all of us. But the scripture also tells us that we're to even love and even pray for our enemies. And that's where it gets hard. That's the difficult part of love. And that's what God has done. It says that when we were enemies of God, that he sent his son to die for us. He sent his son to pay for our sins. So we need to make sure we love everybody, even the people that we don't particularly agree with, we don't even like. That part of love is difficult. In Romans 5, 6 and 8, it says, while we were still weak at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, but perhaps for a good person, one would dare to even die. And God shows his love for us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. That is something that we need to understand. If God did that for us, and we're supposed to be made into like Christ-likeness, if we're supposed to show that Christ-like love to this world, that's what we should represent. That's who we should be in this world. It says in these verses that people haven't seen God, but if they see love in us, they have seen him. Even though they don't think they've seen him, they've caught a glimpse of him. That we're supposed to show that to each other. And I think that is, if we want the world to change, we need to make sure that we're displaying that love for each other. That we're looking, we're seeking out those things. In verses 11 and 12, it gives us the call to love each other. Verse 11, it says that no one has seen God, but we can find that evidence through loving each other. And in 1 Peter 4:8, it tells us to love each other deeply because love covers over a multitude of sins. You know, the people in my life that I truly love and that I know love me, even if they've made mistakes, even if they haven't handled things as well as I think they should, I still love them, right? But God loves us that way. That even when we make mistakes, he doesn't quit on us. He still loves us. And aren't you thankful for that?
Amen.
If I do err on any side, I want to err on the side of love. I want to make sure I handle love in the right way. It's God's definition of what love is. But if I err in any way, I want it to be on the side of love. Because that's the only thing that can cover up. It covers up our sins because of God's love for us in Jesus. In verse 13, we see evidence of God's love abiding with us, living with us, doing life with us through the Holy Spirit. In 14, we're told to testify to who Jesus is. We're supposed to go and we're telling the world about who Jesus is. And in verse 17, it tells us that love, being perfected in love, that if we love God, we love people, we're seeking righteousness. This is the perfection that we're seeking after. We're seeking after showing the world who Jesus is by the way we love each other, by the way we strive to love God, by the way we strive to love each other. And in verses 18 and 19, we're told that fear and love are contrasting things. They don't belong together. And that's hard to really understand it, but here's what I do know. I know that now, me living for Christ is not because I'm scared of going to hell. I believe hell is a reality. It's a real thing. But my love for Christ, my devotion to him, my purpose in serving him is because I understand that he loved me first, and I want to love him too. Not because I'm just scared of the punishment that he brings, but I want to show the world his love, what he can do in them, what he can do for them, what he's doing for them. So we need to make sure that we try to show the world those things, what he's done for us, how he's loved us, and that there is no fear in love, that they are opposite things. Verse 20 reminds us again that God loves us first, And in verse 21, we're basically called a hypocrite if we don't love each other. We don't love our neighbor. We don't love our brother and sister, not just the brother and sister in Christ. How are we ever going to share the gospel and have more people know Christ if we don't love the people who are not in Christ yet? We have to love them too. If we want to be different, we want to be set apart, we want to be used to show the world who God is, I think that's important. And then verse 21 again just sums it up, that if we love God, we have to love each other. If we can't love, if we don't love someone we can see, how can we love God who we don't see? I think it's a hard call for us as Christians, but I think the world needs it. It's always needed it. But we can definitely see it now. We need to see love from us. From us, as we said, that we know God, we know who He is, we know His Son Jesus, we have the Holy Spirit living within us. We have to love different than what the world says love is. We have to use God's definition of it. But we need to make sure that we show that to people today. So my last three questions that I have for you is, one, have you accepted the love of Jesus Christ? Is He your Lord and your Savior of your life? Because that's one of the questions we have to ask first. Are there people, or is there someone that you have not loved that you need to learn to love today? I can tell you this, that Deborah and I were watching a show the other day, and something happened in the show. It happened to this lady that this guy loved, and I was thinking to myself, I actually told Deborah, like, I would be so angry, and this is what I would do, and all this kind of stuff. And then I thought, well, that's not what God's called me to do. He's called me to love even though someone's my enemy. I still love them. I was an enemy of God. But that should change us. So we can all probably say there's people that we don't love the way we should. They may look different than us. They may act different than us. They may have different opinions than us. But we're still called to love. We're called to hold to what is right. But we're still called to love. And then the last question is, will we do something about it? Because a lot of times God puts things in our hearts, and sometimes we can just dismiss it. And we'll say, well, I understand that that's wrong, but I don't want to do anything about it. And that's wrong of us. And when I stand before Jesus, when I actually heard Robbie Zacharias, and they asked him, they said, what would you say to Jesus? What are your first words to Jesus going to be? He said, I'm not worried about what I would say. I'm worried about what He's going to say. What is He going to say to me? And when I think about that, I'm thinking about what He was going to say to me. I don't want Him to say to me, hey, I asked you and asked you and asked you to change. But you could have reached more people potentially, but you never did. You didn't change. I don't want Him to say that to me. I want Him to say, well done, my good and faithful servant. Because there's no better words that we could ever hear when we stand before God and hear those words. So if there's someone we have not loved, make sure that we do something about it. First thing you can do is pray about it. If you start praying for people that, diligently praying for people that you have a problem with, God may not change them, but He will change you. He can change them. If we're diligent in our prayer, I believe He will, eventually, but I guarantee He'll change you. So you'll learn to love them, even the difficult people in this world that disagree with us. And I think that's something the world needs to see from us, especially during these times, because the answer everybody's looking for, God gave us 2,000 years ago. We can clearly see it in His Word, and that's what we need to show to people. That we don't only say we believe it, we're living it out. Let's pray. Father God, I just want to say thank you. Thank you for all you've done for us. Thank you for the love you've shown us in Jesus Christ. And Father, help us to show people by the way we live that we do believe in Jesus. We understand what He's done for us. And we're going to live it out each and every day in a way that glorifies You, praises Your name, and Father, shows people that we truly believe in what we say we do believe in. We live it. So Father, thank You for Jesus. Thank You for what He's done for us. And thank You for all You're doing in our lives. We ask these things in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Tony. And before we leave this morning, I want to just share three things real quickly. Number one, remember the announcement about BBS. If you're willing to help on one of those 4 dates, please get in touch with Sherry Johnson this week. If you didn't get that number, you can call and get it from myself or from Kathy Daly. The second thing, don't forget Wednesday night, 6 o'clock, Brother Tony will be bringing a message on Facebook Live. Hope you'll tune in to that and just worship the Lord with him. And number three, as you leave this morning, be sure to practice driving courtesy. The last thing we need as people leave here on Sunday morning right now is to run into each other. So just be careful. Watch as you back out. Watch as you leave. And I hope you have a great week. May the Lord bless you. Lift each other up in your prayers. And let's just thank God for his blessings today. Remember, you're loved and you're prayed for every day.